Can you elaborate on the second aspect of the five aggregates of forming mind? Now, this is a very good question. The first aspect of the five aggregates of forming mind is as a human being. As a human being, we have a physical body or a form and a mind trapped inside. The Buddha subdivided the mind into four more aggregates of feeling, perception, activity of mind or sankhara, and consciousness. Since the mind is the knowing element, and anything that the mind knows is the form in the mind. Hence, you also have the five mental aggregates of form and mind within every moment of sense experience or sense of consciousness. So this is the second aspect of the five aggregates of form and mind. And the external form enters the mind via the mental perception or the mental aggregates of sanya, perception. So this sanya is memory, perception, knowledge. In Pali, it's termed sanya. Like the external form of the Buddha image, how does this external form enter the mind? Via the seeing consciousness and the mental perception via memory. This second aspect, which is the five mental aggregates of form and mind that arise and pass away with every moment of sense, the experience of consciousness, is the more important one that the Buddha talks about or describes under his Paticchasamuppada teaching. Dependent origination teaching or dwelling. The text mostly explain the dwelling using the first aspect of the five aggregates of form and mind, with the dwelling occurring only once over three lifespan. And this type of Paticchasamuppada is of not much use. It explained that dependent on the first link of avijja or ignorance, it conditioned karmic volition or sankhara, then karmic volition conditioned rebirth consciousness of jnana. And dependent on the rebirth consciousness, form and mind or namarupa, the human being comes to be. Dependent on the human being, the sixth sense basis of salayatana comes to be. To them, this is the only possible logical way of explaining it. That's why all the commentaries, even the Visuddhimagga, they explain it this way. So if based on this, you cannot learn, it's of not much use. This type of Paticchasamuppada occurring only once over three lifespan is of not much use. But the one that cultivator realized, which I personally also realized, I realized it's not the three lifespan. I can explain it. It is within the moment, every moment, every instant, continuously arise. And it's multidimensional. It's not a single dimensional telling. So a more detailed explanation will be required. So to understand that, maybe you can read my book, the Paticchasamuppada book. There is a transcript book developed in the year 2005 when I started coming out to share. From that 2-hour talk, they transcribed the whole book. And that book is very good. You should read through. And maybe I will explain the first aspect again to benefit people who are new. You see, according to the Buddha, he said, as a human being or a living being, we have this physical form. We call it the rupa aggregate. Then we have a consciousness trapped inside. This is the mental aspect or consciousness aspect. He said he can subdivide this consciousness into four more aggregates. So aggregates are like specific heaps or group. So it's like you can separate them. In order to understand the four aggregates of mind, the easiest way is to ask yourself this question, to inquire, what can your mind do? Then you will understand. Okay. That's why you have to start from basic, clean slate, assume you don't know anything. Then you ask, what can my mind do? Then you understand why the Buddha subdivide the four aggregates of mind into these four. He said, first is the aggregate of Vedana. Feeling. Then you reflect, hey, yeah, my mind can feel. Hot or cold, I can feel. So the Buddha is right. There's an aggregate of feeling. pleasant, unpleasant. I can feel them. Nice and not nice. Pleasant and unpleasant, mind state. I can feel them. I can experience them. So that is the aggregate of feeling. Then we move on. We ask ourselves, what can our mind do? Then the second aggregate, the Buddha said, you can perceive. Perception is an ability of your mind. Through your seeing consciousness, you can perceive what you see. Hearing consciousness, you can perceive what you hear. Smell, taste, tactile, thought process, and the mind. You can also perceive what you perceive in the respective sense of consciousness. So perception is an ability of the mind. And perception is a very important aggregate. Well, whatever you perceive is the external form, and this is the one you bring into the mind. That's why there is also this mental form that enters the mind through the aggregate of sanya. And this brings about the second aspect of the five aggregate of form and mind. I will explain later. So the second aggregate of sanya is very clear. The mind can perceive whatever you see, you hear, you smell, you taste, you tactile, feel all things. Then the third aggregate, the Buddha say, is sankhara. So what is sankhara? They have to use a lot of English words to actually explain this word sankhara. In fact, all the English equivalent that they have come up with, they also couldn't completely explain what sankhara is. And through my understanding, I have come up with one very complete definition of sankhara. Everything that your mind can do is sankhara, including feeling and perception. And there's a reason why the Buddha separate feeling and perception out. That I have explained earlier on. Feeling is because feeling is a very important aspect of Dhamma. Under the dwelling, upon contact, feeling arise. Then feeling, condition, craving. So that is under Patisasamuppada. Then there is under the four foundation of mindfulness, Vedana Nupassana, mindfulness of feeling. That's why it's separated out. Okay. Then Sanya is also separated out. Where this is the one that brings the external form into the mind. This is the mirage. This is the one that create illusion, image. Okay. That's why it's separated. Then whatever the mind can do is sankhara. That's why they define under the English translation. They say mental intention is sankhara. Mental activity is sankhara. Activity means your thinking and all those things. Then mental state is also sankhara. Then mental formation is also sankhara. So all these words, they never define completely what sankhara is. Because to tell you the truth, all of your contemplation, reflection, even your scheming, planning, deceitfulness, these are part of sankhara activity. That's why sankhara covers the whole of content of consciousness. Whatever that your mind can do, your views, your opinion, your conditioning, is all part of sankhara. And this is a very major understanding. That's why without seeing this in the meditation, you can never understand what the Buddha meant by sankhara. And that is the reason why he always used only this word, sankhara. Sabbe sankhara anicham. Enough, finish. But everything that your mind can do is sankhara. And that is anicham, including feeling and perception and consciousness. That's sabbe sankhara dukkham. You want it your way, which is not nature's way, it will lead to suffering. Then finally, sabbe dhamma, not only the conditioned world, the unconditioned included, is sabbe dhamma anatta. When it comes to anatta, empty nature, non-self nature, not a permanent unchanging entity, he used the word dhamma. Sankhara is for the conditioned world. Dhamma includes the unconditioned. That's why this word sankhara is very powerful, very important. And when you understand sankhara, you understand deeply the Dhamma that the Buddha teach. Then apart from this content of consciousness, what else can your mind do? The last one, he said, is consciousness. Then you reflect and contemplate, yeah, what else can my mind do? My mind can be conscious. Conscious of what I see. Conscious of what I hear, I smell, I taste, I tactile feel and think. Then you realize the Buddha is so wise. That's why these four aggregates define the whole of mind, the mandala. So the four aggregates of mind together with the physical body is the five aggregates. That's why nama, rupa, form and mind, the first aspect of the human being or living being. Then the second aspect is every moment of sense experience, we have the four aggregates of mind. Vedana, sanya, sankara, viyana. Then how did the form enter the mind? Through the perception aggregate. That's why the mental form enters. And that is the second aspect of five aggregate of mind. That is the one that the Buddha meant under the Paticca-samuppada. That's why the whole of the Paticca-samuppada can be explained. It's instantaneous. Every moment, every instant arising. So under the real teaching, you listen. Avijja paccaya sankhara, the meaning is already clear. Dependent on ignorance. Ignorant of what? Ignorant of the truth. Ignorant of Dhamma. Especially the three spiritual law. Kama niyama, citta niyama, Dhamma niyama. Means universal order of karma, mind, and truth. As taught by the Buddha. If you don't have right view with regards to these three spiritual law, you will get into trouble. And the Buddha said, you have ignorant avijja. And because you don't understand, you want to know, what do? You think. That's why avijja paccaya sankhara, you think a lot. So when you think, what happened? You make contact with the brain. And your brain is an organ, like the physics experiment. Upon contact, what happened? The light bulb lights up. You become conscious. That's why the third link is avijja paccaya sankhara, sankhara paccaya vijnana. Vijnana need not be rebirth consciousness. Vijnana is that moment when your sankhara make contact with the brain, which is an organ, straight away, like the light bulb lights up, means the mental consciousness come to be. You become conscious. Like the Buddha say, in the seeing, there is only the seeing consciousness. The content hasn't gone in yet. It's like avijja paccaya sankhara, sankhara paccaya vijnana. Then vijnana paccaya nama rupa. The second aspect of five aggregate of form might come about. Why? Because you have inputted the content of consciousness. So when the content of consciousness go in, it become nama rupa. The second aspect of five aggregate of form mind. That's how the 12 link happened. That's why every moment, every instant it arises. Every time you think, you make contact, you create mental consciousness. Then you input the content, the mental aggregate come out. Then the second aspect of the five aggregate will continue the link. Then the Buddha said, dependent on this five aggregate of form and mind, the second aspect, there must be salayatana, sense basis. Otherwise, it cannot arise, either for one or the sense of. When you make contact with the eye, seeing consciousness is the same. You perceive through your seeing consciousness. So the perception bringing the external form that you perceive through your seeing consciousness. So all this brings about the five aggregates of form and mind. Then from there, it moves. So salayatana will condition contact. Because of the sense basis, it will condition contact. Then contact will condition feeling. Feeling will condition craving. So the whole dwelling continues. Yeah. But it is multidimensional. Because the first two links, avijja paccaya sankhara, also has ignorance inside there. So dependent on ignorant contact, straight away feeling already exists there actually. All this, the seven universes, they simultaneously arise. That's the reason why I say it's multidimensional. Then sometimes the link didn't finish. Straight away another sense law take over. Then it triggers off that cycle again. Yeah. Then it depends on your awareness, your mindfulness, and your stability or understanding. That's why you can decide to be aware or to allow the thing to continue. Then you have wisdom to actually stop the link from proliferation and condition you into creating, leading to all the suffering and misery. So all this is Dhamma, the real understanding. Okay? Normally in the retreat, I will elaborate on this because I have the whiteboard and all those things. Then there's a lot of interaction. But here, I can only do it through the video conferencing. But hopefully it's good enough. Eh? Okay, so we move on. So at least we finish 2.3. Yeah? So now we move on to 2.4. Oh, sorry, there's another paragraph. Eh? Okay, I haven't finished the last paragraph. Whereas the actual dwelling, okay, I read through this one. I think it will help you. Whereas the actual dwelling on page 69, page 68, the second paragraph. Whereas the actual dwelling, using the second aspect, can also be explained if one understands how our mind functions or operates as taught by the Buddha. According to the Buddha, dependent origination occurs within every moment of sense experience, sense or consciousness. That is, dependent or ignorant, not understanding the truth and wanting to know if conditioned mental volition or activity, mundane perception and thinking, etc. Then dependent on thinking or mundane volition, it creates contact that trigger of mental consciousness instead of rebirth consciousness. Yeah, that one is when you think, you make contact with the brain. That's why mental consciousness come up. The brain is the mind organ. My organ, that's how it trigger off mental consciousness. So this mental consciousness is very important. Yeah? That is dependent on ignorance, yeah? Not understanding the truth and wanting to know it conditioned mental volition or activity, mundane perception and thinking, etc. Then dependent on thinking or mundane volition, it creates mental contact that trigger off mental or thought consciousness instead of rebirth consciousness. Because mind is also an organ. Eh? Mm. Then dependent on mental or thought consciousness, the content of consciousness will follow to arise the five mental aggregates of form and mind, the second aspect. Then dependent on this form and mind, there must be this sense basis. Hence the flow of dependent origination of paticca-samuppada as taught by the Buddha. This second aspect is seldom taught because it's very difficult for most cultivators to have the understanding to share, unless they themselves have realized the paticca-samuppada happening within their own form and mind. That's the reason why you hardly hear of this teaching